code. So for title means we have a quantum bind model, LH lambda, where I own the using is in the relation, omega is related to the curvature of our one L, the curvature L. Lambda is what the polarization is. I will not rewrite it again, so it's but the data was the following, so I have to try a little bit, maybe sorry for this. The data was then the following, that we consider that L tensor M H, so the metric, this is what the metric in quantum, and you also put here now the induced metric in the L tensor power. So will this be denoted just by symbol by Lm? And so integers. So this was the setup, and on this setup we defined the triplets operator of level M. This was our okay, maybe first important data I should not forget. This is the following, this is the scalar product. We have a scalar product. Which comes from the scalar product of the emission metric in the bundle, and we integrate over our manifold M, so we have something like M, we have H, M, so because we are going to have an M now, phi, psi, and we have here a little measure, so maybe do some scaling, but this doesn't work matter. This is now our scalar product psi M, if needed we write an M there, where our phi and psi are C infinity sections of our bundle Lm. So in this context we have also then the holomorphic sections. Let's say we have to say the bounded holomorphic section, so we can take the, let's take the effect, I mean the L2 completion, but let us skip this, so we can have take the L2 completion of the space of sections, so we can see infinity sections, and then there is the holomorphic sections are a closed subspace of this L2 space there. But they consist here indeed of sections. So we have the projection by M going from gamma infinity away from L2 letter Lm to the gamma hol bounded Lm. So this was the general setup, and this is proof for compact, non-compact Gamma manifolds. We can write this are the triplet operator for quantizable Gamma manifolds. Good. So this is of level, I did not say the triplet operator is a projector. Now, the triplet operator was defined to be, I take the function F. I'm sorry for the little really bothered by triplet operators, it was a warning. Now again, so, and even in Tarek's talk, in another house there. So, but I have to say that these are different facets, so it's not just a copy. Let's say the ideas are in some sense, the notion, the ideas are similar, but nevertheless the setup is different. Yeah. So we take, we associate an operator operating on this space here. So, this operates on the space of either. Now maybe let me stick again now to the compact bound, get rid of the boundedness. The condition there, so this is on the space of holomorphic sections of the bundle Lm. So it is defined as we take S, and now we take the S, and multiply it with our function F. So this is the multiplication operator. With this we obtain something which is a C infinity function, and we project it down again on the subspace of holomorphic sections. This is M. this is the turbulence operator of level M. But as I said, for us in this context, what we as interpret from translation, this is the whole collection of these operators. So we have, we assign to it this sequence, this family of BFM. The M runs through all the possible integer. This is our Bayes interpretive operator, or quantum, sorry, I should say our quantum operator. Yeah. And these are the individual levels or modes, how we call it also. Good. So this is here on the slide, you see it again. So in contrast to this, what did this morning, in some sense, that is from the very beginning, there is some parameter there already. The M is from the geometry already there, and because we don't know what that's about. Okay, good. Before I will say about, I will give results, and I will think about a remark, but I will not return to this later. But nevertheless, this remark is quite interesting here. So here I have here the sequence of light bundles LM. Indeed, it is possible to incorporate in some kind of code theory also auxiliary Hermitian holomorphic light bundle E, and consider L tensor M tensor E. The E is this additional vector. So what, and then consider corresponding turbulence operators. But why one does this? Okay, good, very good question. So you are going ahead, because I'm going to just say now. Because let's say that one of the important things already is the following. If E is a light bundle, it's the square root of the canonical bundle. So the canonical bundle, this is the bundle of holomorphic differentials. And so in a good situation, then it has a square root. You can take the square root of this bundle. For example, for Riemann surface, it exists always. So you can take the square root. And if you take this as a square root, then it is called the Bayes compensation with metaplectic correction. So this is the metaplectic correction. So the metaplectic correction has certain, in some sense, it is even needed for certain things. Traditionally, it says, okay, you only with metaplectic correction to get the right values. But this is not, for me, mathematically, not the main point. For me, mathematically, this is the following point here. If you want to say something like quantization computes the reduction, this is one of the slogans for what one wants to prove. So if you ignore the metaplectic correction, you do not get such kind of a statement. For the operators. So because the point is the following, only to do this, you get at least asymptotically, you get unitarity for quantization of reduction. So it's very natural way to do it. It makes things a little bit complicated, but I will not do it here, okay? Another thing is if you consider
so
the point is easy. We have now on the manifold M, light bundle L, you have now the sections of this here, then you take group action. And you divide out now that if with M1G, they have L1G the bundle. And now the question is if we have the map from the sections there, if you now let's say the G invited sections of the manifold for the manifold M and the bundle L, can they be identified with the sections on the quotient? That's the point here. And of course, here, let's say one part of quantization commutes with reduction is that the dimension of the spaces is the same. And this is in a lot of cases is shown. But this is only one part. Another part is that whether the scalar products are the same. And this means that here, that this is that. It is shown that it's not. Is it necessary that I should? No, oh, okay, maybe. Mm-hmm. But maybe you can realize that in here, but. So this is this is also a part of the statement there. But you can show that indeed it's not, this is never unitary, but the question of course, okay, in this business, it's always asymptotically the question. And it is only if you make better practical action to get this question. Okay? So, or other thing is if you consider families of caveman clothes, families of conversation. To make this natural, then again the same situation is this, you better do it with better information. Now you might ask, okay, maybe now back the bundle, but now I'm really a little bit surprised because I thought that you and Mary have once did something about quantization of finite dimensional vector spaces. No, but you did, but he was not involved, what?
We did it together.
But the point is, you see, this key, what is P is here, this element, this vector bundle degree, this is some kind of inner degrees of freedom. You have a generic degree of freedom for the bundle, and then you have inner degree of freedom. So you can construct theories which have which are maybe non-competent or have inner degree of freedom.
That probably would correspond to what was called in Quinn's shape jargon vector coefficients.
Yeah,
the way in position with vector coefficients.
Okay. But this was just a remark which I will not return anymore. But now I come to the central result. The point of my idea of this lecture is now I will, in some sense, present you first some of the important results, and then I will talk as far as it's possible, as far as I think it makes sense to talk about the proofs. So I will not go literally and not prove and so on. But this is now the approximation result for compact caveman clothes. So it consists of essentially of three parts. We have the first part, this says the following, that is, if I take the trapez operator, in its operator norm, you see the trapez operator operating on sections. So I can do, I have this vector, this string product here, I can take the operator norm. And it says asymptotically, the operator norm converges to the sub norm of the function. So this is rather innocent proof in my society, but for us in this when we proved it, I think in 94 or something, it was the hardest part. Now, together with Alexander Karl Jacob, I found that I had a certain conjecture and I was able to prove this with him later with the help of the Parasitic transform. I have a much simpler proof of this. This I will show later, not this original
algebra.
You see, we have simplicity function of the manifold is compact.
So it's a C-square algebra.
Yeah, it's just a maximum. So
yeah.
What is a good point of this idea? I will return to this. When I start with this, because in some sense, this was our starting point, we wanted to have this bracket, so we should take the bracket of the circuit operators, and for compensation of the comparability of the operator corresponding to the Poisson bracket, so this is the bracket of the quantum operator with this operator of the Poisson bracket, they should be related. But the relation there is all everywhere, then this H bar involved there, so it's not identity. But if one checks this directly, one sees okay. When I multiply now this bracket by m, this is again asymptotically equal to the operator coming from the puzzle. At the same time, you see this is over 1 over m, we have a statement more precisely sequence, anyhow. But it's not so important. You see, if I now take the M, the M runs through all the integer quantities. If I take instead of the M, 1 over M, then I get bracket is equal to minus, and call this H bar M, and indicate this is this D. Then I get the minus H bar T F G. This is exactly if it would be equal to 0, then it would be a condition, or zero condition. Indeed, then the next step, the next statement is the following, how they are related, how the product function is equalized to them, how they are related to the quantum the product of the quantum operators. And we show that this is here, that it's. So, that this is asymptotically the case. As I said, I will sketch the proof of B and C later. For this, I have to introduce what is called the simple generalized Dirichlet's operator calculus of the Fourier model and Gilliland. And by this, this EMM will be individual mode of a generalized Dirichlet operator. And by using it, the simple calculus, one shows this problem. Here, as I said, I will use Bramson transform techniques to prove it. So in some sense, this is the remark that I said, okay, it's good that you set CSR, one because one can say this here, that the Bramson-Triplet's quantization scheme for out-of-form material control has a correct civic decimal behavior. Or this is some other version of the same. It is a strict quantization of the CSR people, or it's a continuous field of C-star algebras. That's the point. So yeah, this is a really continuous field. The continuous field, you see that, okay, good. We take, so what we have here, the direct sum of what I can say, we have this. Let me write this. This is C infinity, this is this C infinity M, okay, cross, and now we have this gamma, N gamma whole M, okay, and here I should of course take product over M. So this is the product of this whole, the C star algebra C infinity M. And here this is this finite dimensional F algebras. And I have here, you see, I have here the operator norms of this are all C stars of us. And continuous field means I define a section there. And the section is exactly F. Is to F. F. 1, F2, etc., etc. And the point is about, and of course, because I said, maybe this was in the middle, maybe this was the main part. So the set over which we consider the continuous field, this is 0 and 1 over m. M 1 is 2, which is positive. Natural numbers here. So this is a set, this is a subset of that I've been about. It has 0 as the unique accumulation point. And it's a discrete subset.
Why do you call it a continuous?
Yeah, you see, because it is good point. It's not continuous in the sense of continuous set. It's continuous in the sense of a section. You see, this section is continuous. What does this mean? It does mean if you approach. You see, this is the accumulation point of 0. Yeah. And so this is exactly sometimes this property here. This is this property that is a continuous field of system. Okay, good. Addition here are condition because this is one. Good. Now, some other results. which I will come back to this later, this certain part that I will have for them. Read this again, but nevertheless, just to get you a feeling of the Tirpitz map. You see, the Tirpitz map here is different than the one, behaves different in a certain way than the one which was discussed by Professor English this morning. The first thing is that the Tirpitz map here, of a fixed level, I should have to say that it won't be with a fixed level n, so the fixed. So when I assign to the function f, now this operator here f. Of course, if you want to choose a basis, then you can say it in the selection that you get it's a matrix, you see this matrix. But this is not so really natural, because you cannot choose a basis in a Fourier way, so anyhow. These are just matrix algebras in a certain sense. So this is a map from this infinite dimensional C star algebra to this finite dimensional C star algebra. And the statement is that this map is surjective. This meaning that every operator in every element from here is indeed a Tirpitz operator. But the point is that you see if I have A have an operator, okay, then I know A. So A is operator level M, meaning that I have this is fixed, M is fixed. Then A will be a Tirpitz operator of level M, of course, but it will, with respect to a certain function, because otherwise it will call it a Tirpitz operator. But this function, this might depend on Bm, because there is, of course, not defined for everything, only for this level. So every operator is a Tirpitz operator. As keep in mind, it's not a universal Tirpitz operator, but it is also a universal. And then we come to this in the next slide, I guess. Another thing is which appeared in a similar situation or this morning here. So also maybe I should say I'm not sure which of the differences. So if I take now a real value function f, then the operator in f is a function. It's like this one also in this the Fox space business there. Indeed, it's been like this, that if I take now a self-adjoint operator from here, then there exists a real valid function f such that f is a clear. F is a clear, this should also depend on the m. But this is a different situation now. The Tirpitz map is never injected. Sorry?
Yeah, it's not bad.
Yeah. The point is, I reminded you, M is compact. So this means, because you see, you cannot expect it to subject, because it's interdimensional space, and these are always finer dimensional spaces. So you cannot expect that the individual or the individual level is injective. But it is asymptotically injective. This is a fault. It is asymptotically injective. Why? So this means, what does this mean? It means if I have now really a function f and g, if I have functions f and g, I consider now for this difference of these five functions, now the temperature pressure, this is EFM. So if this asymptotically means if m goes to infinity, then by the previous result, by this result here, it follows that indeed the subnorm of the difference, because this will be zero, and the subnorm of the difference will be zero too. Okay, and so this means that f is equal to g. So we can check whether two functions are the same by considering the sequence of Tirpitz operator. And if the sequence of Tirpitz operator has as limit point 0, we know these two functions have the same from the very beginning. It looks rather harmless, but there are applications in topological field theory which exactly uses such kind of statement there. Where you can, because you see the level of the triplets operators are finite dimensional stuff, you can distinguish what happens. You can consider the limits, because all the things finite dimensional are fixed levels. You consider the limit, and you show that the limit is the zero of the operator. This is a zero operator, or it's norm. Let's say more precisely, the norm is zero, then it's zero, and then you show the individual functions are nice. Okay. I want to show you another point, which is related to the fact that the triplets F is surjective on every level individually. So there is this operator of general quantization. So this is a more traditional general quantization here. So it is, if you never saw it, just it's not important because you're not interested in it. So I mean here. Because you do not ask the question how it's related to general quantization. But if you saw it, it's a natural question. It's a more complicated operator. You see, because we have here, this would be the multiplication operator, but here we have something here. Covariant derivative, has a total vector here, given the function f is more, it's complicated. You take derivatives, you have to take derivatives, and so on, so it's rather complicated. In general quantization, we know that you need to choose a polarization to obtain what you want. And in general, it's not unique, but in our complex situation, there's a canonical one. We just take again the projector down to the holomorphic space. This is a canonical one, there is no choice under the law. So this is the polarization which we choose. So it's QFM will be now EFM after the subtraction. Now, by the subjectivity of triplets, then, it can be written as a triplet operator of a function FM. When FM may be a little different for every M. And indeed, this was a result, the early result by Kaiser, without the reference to the triplets. He showed that indeed this triplet, that from the triplet quantization operator, can be given as a triplet operator. Now the function f minus 1 of the f double r square. What do you gain by this? Here you differentiate sections. So the operator is given from differentiating sections. And here you differentiate only the function. So why is this true? Essentially it's true because of Stokes theorem. So if you go to the proof, then you see if you essentially the Stokes theorem, let's say partial integration in Stokes theorem. This is both of them. By partial integration you move it to the final function, and by Stokes theorem you get a disturbance of Milnerish. But you see Stokes theorem says, at least the proof will not work for non-compact manifolds, scalar manifolds. At least the proof will not work, but indeed the statement is also not true. So this is a statement which gives it compact scalar manifolds. The next point, which is there in this context, but in some sense, the third condition, which I've written down, something like TFM times T, TMG times TMF is essentially is up to say higher order equal to TMF times G. This looks indeed for similar to the star product. For me now, fortunately, I already introduced also in the morning, so at least I can say what the star product is directly. But I don't know whether everybody was here in the morning. Is it clear to everybody that I can rush rather fast? Or should I redo it again? Please, be honest. Should I redo it again? Okay, good. So the point is that there's one other approach to quantization, which is what operator, and the other one was deformation quantization. You want to deform the product. The pointwise product should be deformed in a non-primitive direction, and maybe the first order should be good, roughly speaking, in the direction of the possible pressure. So this is a non-primitive deformation, and the idea is maybe to take the C infinity M and just write down a non-primitive product. But then it turns out that this will not work. The way out, which was done by these inventors of this interpretation, was let's do it in a bigger algebra. Let's consider the formal power series with coefficient given by the functions. So this is so we take now the formal power series. The variable is mu. This is the formal variable. And this here is now, the coefficients are now C infinity functions. And in the new stock, an asymptotic product star should be an asymptotic product. The point is that we should like to have in the limit, in certain sense, by ignoring higher terms of the variable, that we should get like in the classical situation for this means that if you take F star G is now something from here. But if we ignore all powers of the new from the variable, it should be just a pointwise product of F times G. Next thing is that, as I said, it should be the first order level should be correspond to the Poisson bracket. So if I take now F star G minus T star F, first of course by this one it will be modulo mu and will be zero. So there is now there is no to the power 1 term. So I can divide it. There's got mu to the power 0 term. I can divide it by the mu, and I get, in this case I get now this Poisson bracket. That is a certain factor I. And if you open books on deformation quantization of star products, you will see all conventions. Whether I minus I or just nothing or something, this whatever. It depends on your personal convention there. But what is here, we have handwritten as F star G is H. We have now four power series here, mu to the power K, and here we have CK FG. Where CK FG, this is by the definition here, these are now C infinity functions. It should be a product. Should be bilinear, This means that that indeed the students are bilinear also in this argument here. And if we check what's here, then it's exactly the same here. C0 is F times G, C1 minus C1, Gf opposite is now just minus Ifg. I guess I forgot here the minus, but don't care, this is not so important. There's an additional property, and there's one property, it's the same one as it was this morning, that was mentioned there. The function 1, should remain the unit. So one times, the one star f should be one times, should be f. This is sometimes called null and constant, so okay. But the other property, I think was implicitly. I know it was, I would say the mirror image head is in mind, but it did not, as far as I did not memorize this here, it did by the double, so when you mention it, the star movement should be local. Because for certain applications, they should even drop this condition. But in this context, what I'm dealing here, we should not drop it, we cannot drop it, because otherwise things will not, for some things will not work. The local means the following. I have C chain FG, these are C infinity functions, okay? And now we can ask, where is the support of the function here? So the point is that if for the points which are not happy, then we would like this, the common support of FG, the C chain should vanish. Should be zero, so this should, so, and this, recipes don't work in direct way. But in fact, there is some kind of verifying this. There is another equivalent condition for this. This CJ here, these are bidirectional operators. So this is Gödel's result, if you want to use this name. They are bidirectional operators. So it's not assumed in general. But you have to be careful to check whether it's an assumption that the star product is local or has bidirectional.
I had a question.
Yeah,
please. If you go on to the previous slide.
The previous one?
Yeah. Is there a possibility to introduce more than one parameter here?
Yeah. You can do this. Yeah, this is possible.
Like one of our series,
you can do this. In fact, you can even consider situations which I myself I did not do, but I don't know whether everybody already did it. By considering, let's say, not just one line button, but a text button, let's say different line buttons and thousands, or you can do something where the interpreter's like, or in some situation, you get multi, you get some kind of
multi-parameter
thing. This is possible. Good. So, equivalence of star products, so this we have just to use one slide there.
He asked that question because we have a physical situation where we would like to do this.
Ah, okay.
We have a very important kind of operator with a function of it would appear by taking a group and simply extending it in more than one.
I have to say that I personally did not do it, and I also I talked for you some references there, but I have to say we got a letter from P.L. Linge in which he suggested maybe we could also do this. So I can, if you like, I can make a copy of the letter and can
get it. No, but you don't know like a literature or anything
you have done it. I don't know. I know there's a done. So multi-parameter products have been done. I cannot give you now a reference, but this has been done. But relation to parameter interpreters, I never saw it, so it's been done.
I think I saw the literature in the context of quantum groups. Functions,
so
the quantum. So it's done over
here. Yeah, around the group of the Stanheim and Tito, and they did something in this previous spectrum. But not really present, not really terrorist, but in general, Star Flux, Moon, Paramir, and such kind of things. That was something. Okay, good. Equivalence of star products. So the point is that for star products they have a lot of freedom. You can imagine because they have just power series, from the power series, and a lot of freedom. And at least you want to classify them a little bit at least. There is this notion of equivalence there, which is essentially, it says the following, they are isomorphic. When isomorphic is of a certain special kind. So again, we have proper series of operators. This has appeared also in the morning as an example. So we have these operators, then there are proper series of operators. Again, for the variables, this PI are honest operators. The first term is the identity. And now this means that it's isomorphic. And now this is one of the statements, which is a highly non-trivial statement there, that this equivalence class of differential self-product, that is the point, for sure differential self-product, otherwise it's not true. But differential self-products are uniquely classified by the so-called linear Fedosov class. So this Deligny Fedosov class, as the name already says, Deligny is there, Fedosov is there. So you could imagine that it's quite complicated. We statement. But this is a piece of work. So let me check, maybe have a look at this formula. This is the starting point. So my assigns to this starting point for this class, my assigns to it what is called a formal derived convolution class. Okay, formal means again to take here power series from the power series where the coefficients are now there are two Gerham convolution classes of the manifold. This is essentially why is it this one is to predicate the fixed in this sense. So we start with this is here for already. Symplectic, you see, because symplectic is also true for symplectic. We start with symplectic form, or the Taylor form, in its class. This is a term in the order minus, u to the power minus. And then we are on C. So the importance of
this element is the second Gerham cohomology on the manifold.
Oh, yeah.
So what does that formal power series mean?
Yeah, it means
it means the coefficients are taking value from that.
Exactly. It means it's just all this. You see, we have now, let's say, we start 1 over mu, omega, maybe you have the I here. Then the next step is something like we have a form, we have a class. This is now a 2 homology class, mu to the power 0, we have omega 1. Power 1 and so on and so on.
The coefficients are taking values from that vector space.
The coefficients take value from this vector space. Okay. So, good. Now this is a consequence. You see, if this vanish here, meaning of course the homology class vanishes, then there will be nothing there. So, for example, if M is contractible, if M is contractible, then the second cohomology vanishes. It will be not there. So this means that this equivalence, this linear Joseph class will always start here, no higher order terms. And or as a consequence, for contractible manifolds, we have up to equivalence only one starting point. And this is the point, for example, that one can take his favorite subproduct. Typically, one says, okay, the Moyard subproduct. The Moyard subproduct is some kind of a standard subproduct. Moyard by the subproduct, which was there in this little this morning. One can take this subproduct, a former subproduct, one can take this there, but it's only the case for contractible manifolds. Locally, maybe one can say, okay, locally, every subproduct can be is equivalent to the Moyard subproduct. This is also a consequence. So, but for compact Taylor manifolds, there are many different subproducts, of course, but this is already the case for the other ones, but even non-equivalent subproducts. Because you see, because for Taylor manifold, you see a compact Taylor manifold, you have the Taylor form. The Taylor form is a non-vanishing true form. So it is for sure, it is not zero, this H2. Okay? So you can read a lot of that here. And hence, that is the question of is there a star product which is given in a natural way? What natural way means, of course, is not so clear. But the answer is maybe this propaganda, but okay. The answer is yes, the person triple subproduct could be even used to. This is a natural subproduct, does not make any reference to additional choices which we have already done at the very beginning by singling out a quantum line possibility. And with this, we have one subproduct. I don't know how long I should okay, good, because then I want to make some kind of a good cut. And then the point is that, yes, canonical, we have a complex manifold structure. And of course, the point nowadays, of course, because we have this existing theorems and so on and so on. And one can, of course, ask why you're looking for another star product, for other star products. The answer is because you are looking for star products which have certain properties, which respects certain. Let's say if you have a manifold, you have a group acting, you respect, you want to look for star product, which respects the group action, and so that's kind of thing here. And this is exactly also here. We have here a complex manifold, and we are looking for a canon manifold more precisely. We are looking for a star product which respects, in a certain sense, our chaos structure or our complex structure. And good. Let me pause for 5 seconds, so because I realize now that I keep speaking. I don't give you any rest, so because now I start with something, I make a sort of jump. Okay? And it's very important if I was too fast now and I left you line, then maybe you should jump in again, okay? Okay, good. Because I want now to define what this could mean for a star product to respect the complex structure. And this will be a crucial point for the whole lecture also. So it's really important that we go through it slowly. Even if it was already there, this is one. So it's a differential star product. So for differential star product, this is real, as I said, we have this case. This case are bi differential operators in the algebra. So it's called separation of variable type. This is as usual, Alexander Carl, even though they live there. We have the following property. Let's say here in this case, let me check how I wrote it here. F is an anti-holomorphic function. And G is a holomorphic function. Then the conditions are, star product of F is an anti-holomorphic function, an arbitrary function, the point-wise product. And if I take now the arbitrary functions and multiply it with a holomorphic function, is the point-wise product. Okay, now the question, what is the problem? this is a little bit on the slide, but what is the problem? As in this formulation which I said F is anti-holomorphic, G is holomorphic, so then it's a point-wise product, but our M is compact. So there are not so many, besides the concept, not so many. But fortunately, I have already written here every locally defined holomorphic function and anti-holomorphic function. So this statement is a statement which concerns local functions. It's of course another question out there, because our star product is something which is defined in global terms. So we have f star g for f and g global functions. So, but again, implicitly the way out is the following. It is what is called a differential star product. Maybe I should have mentioned also, it's a differential star product. This means the star product, if I have a star product, if I restrict it to a certain open subset, it's again a star product. Restriction is, so if I have U and M open, I have now my star product of M, and I can restrict it to U. This is a star product. For C infinity U. Okay? So I can, by just restricting it there, this has to do with the fact that our CK are bidifferential operators. So they are giving me local terms. If I know how they look at every point locally, I know them. Okay? So by star product, by global star product, defines me for every point, you know, the neighborhood of every. I do not claim that I can go automatically from the local to the global. This is not possible. But if I have a global one, it will define everywhere a local one. Hence, what's written there? Breaks complete sets. Okay. So this is was the original definition of Karl-Wegner. And this can now be reformulated if you check what is there. Because the starter type is given of in terms of the CK. As I said, the CK are defined. If you know the CK, you know their way how they look locally. And now there's a statement is then, and then you can say to check this, that the CK for K bigger than equal to 1 has only derivatives in the holomorphic direction, the first argument, and the holomorphic direction in the second argument. So you can read it off. If you know the CK, you can read it off whether it's of such a thing. Just for the completeness here, there was also this definition of the theorem. It's in such a way by Otten and Waldman, and they call this the starter type of weak type. The point is that I have to say that what I have written there is not original Karl-Wegner proposition, it is opposite of Karl-Wegner proposition. And now I have to say later I was a bit more careful. I call this the separation of variable of weak type and a Karl-Wegner original of anti-weak type, because it just changed the role of this. For this point,